Oh, I can't help but think how it's going to be. I get a little glimpse, you know, of that, what it's going to be like, you know. How many of you know that fellow that lived in Memphis, Tennessee, by the name of Elvis Presley? Yeah. You know, his 68 comeback, he had that, you know, that little platform, and he had his guys there, you know, playing the music and people all around. I think about that when I think we're sitting around the throne with an angel band, just shouting hallelujah to the great I am. And he's going to be in the midst of it. And God Almighty going to be right there in the midst. And he's just going to say, sing it, sing it, sing it, sing it. It's music to my ears. Oh, I know y'all, some of you like music. Oh, yeah, because I get it beside you on the stoplight down here on the street. I heard boom, 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 boom. Yeah, they like music. And boy, what a heavenly music we're going to hear over there. Like, man, it's going to, everything will just be perfect. I sing off key down here, but it'll be perfect over there. Perfection. Oh, David, amen, plays the harp. He played it down here. I'm sure he's playing it over there. Oh, what a beautiful sound. Gable hears the music, and he picks up his horn. It's just another glory. Hallelujah, Mom. Oh, there ain't going to be no night. We're going to just party all day long. Yeah, just keep on partying. Yeah, that's a party. Amen. That's a party that I'm looking forward to attending. Oh, with that said, I'm getting the message, all right? Hush up a little bit. Oh, no, I'm not going to hush up. God called me to preach. He called me to be a big mouth for him. You know, one thing about, amen, preaching the word of God, ain't no time off. He didn't tell me, amen, you got 30 days or you got 40 days, you know, off. You got to be in season and out of season, the Bible says. That means you preach all the time. You witness all the time. Your life, amen, is the Lord's. And he don't ever take a break. That means you too, as a Christian, you don't get a break. You're a witness for him, amen? You're a preacher in a sense. Come on, church. That's your job. No, it's everybody's job who's called on the name of the Lord. All those he loved and saved, amen, are witnesses. And they'll witness not just on Sunday morning, they'll witness around the clock. 7 days a week, 365 days a year, 366 in leap year. You want to add a day or two if you think that's important, amen, you still got to be who you are in Christ on those days as well. Somebody say amen. I'm going to preach to you today, so I'm just buckle up. We're fixing to take off here. Hello. We're fixing to take off. Oh, my goodness. No time to quit. Oh, no time to quit. It's time to keep on keeping on because time is running short. Time is running short. Now, when you was young, you didn't think much about time. And some of you are still there, and some of us passed it. You don't think much about time, but as years go by, you begin to think, amen, life is short. And James is right. Life is just a vapor that appears for a little time, and then it's gone. The Bible said man's life expectancy is 70 years. You get 10 more by reason of strength if you take care of yourself and you do what the Lord requires you to do. He might give you 10 extra years as a bonus. That means you live to 80. Think about the average life. Some don't make it to those dates. But just on the average, if we was to live 70 years or 80 years, think how short that lifespan is. My goodness, if I'm going to live to 70, I only got 7 left. Be 63 this year. Don't look like it, I know. Thank you very much. Amen. Yeah. But I only have 7 years if I live that life expectancy. 7 years. So that's short. That goes by quick. Quick. 63 years went by quick. Some of you, I mean, 70 and 80, it went by quick. Can you get an amen? Life is short. And we got to keep that in mind. So time is of the essence, right? The Bible said, redeem the time. Make the most of the time God has allotted you. And what can benefit, amen, in that time frame? What can benefit you serving God to the fullness and winning others to Jesus Christ? Because that's what he came to earth to do. And the Bible tells me, amen, nobody loves me like Jesus. Nobody loves me like Jesus. My wife don't even love me like Jesus. Come on. My children don't love me like Jesus. Nobody on earth. My mom and dad didn't love me like Jesus. Jesus is the only one who will love me to the end. To the end. He loves me. He'll go far beyond, amen, whatever the limitations is here on earth, because he loves me so. Nobody loves me like Jesus. And once again, God loved each and every one of us that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but could have everlasting life. Jesus went a step further in John 15 in verse 13. He says, greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. No greater love hath no man than this, that a man will lay down his life for his friends. Aren't you glad you're a friend of Jesus? Because he did that very thing for you. He laid down his life. Our men and women who serve in the armed forces of this great country are our friends who lay down their lives for our freedom. They know what they are facing. They know what they can go through. And they know what it is to heed the call when the time to come, to go and lay down their lives for our freedom. Friend, that's love. Love for God and country and for their fellow man. We often call them our heroes because they go in our place sacrificing all for the greater cause. But I want to share with you this morning, as a soldier of the cross, as a soldier of the cross, I know we are facing a great enemy. And you should be aware of that as well, because you are a soldier. God has called you, saved you, to get on the front lines with him. And we have a great enemy out there on the front line, don't we? We confront Satan each and every day of our lives. How many of you confronted him this morning? How many of you, he didn't even bother with you? Because if you raise your hand and tell him, he's already got you. You ain't no concern. You're not a threat to him. But if he bothered you, then you're a threat to him. You are a threat to him. Satan is out to destroy you. He's out to destroy your souls. He's out to destroy your family. And he's out to destroy your friends. In 1 Peter 5:8, the Bible tells me that to be sober. And what does that mean? To be clear thinking, be alert, be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion, walking about seeking whom he may devour. In other words, he's as a hungry lion, amen, out seeking his prey. He wants to eat you for dinner, by the way. Hello? Don't give him lunch today. Don't give him lunch today. Put him in his place. He's your enemy. And how does he attack us? How does he get to us? I want to know. I want to look out for him. I want to be aware of what he can do. Don't you? If he's out there to eat me for lunch, I certainly want to be on the lookout for him. So how is he going to get to me? Well, he'll cause a little thing to come upon you called, what was that? Somebody said it. Depression. Oh, he wants to get you under that cloud of doom and gloom. Anybody been there by him? Amen. Oh, when he gets you under that cloud, oh, he'll lower your self-esteem, make you think you ain't nothing. I got news for him. I got news for him. I'm a king's kid. I'm valuable. I'm worth something. I got a purpose. And I got a need. Amen. People need me. People need me. They need you. They need you. Matter of fact, this whole preacher needs you. I need you. If nothing else, just to pray for me. Come on. Oh, boy, when we see somebody like that, we need to give a helping hand. We need to lift them up. See, this world, amen, the devil, amen, is in control of it. And he wants to keep you depressed. He wants to keep you pressed down. And he'll use people to put you down. Hey, it's enough of that. Amen. We need to stop that. We need to lift one another up. Lift one another up. Boy, I tell you what, everybody's got faults. Hey, none of us righteous, no, not one. That's why Jesus, amen, loved us enough to die for us when we were miserable, amen, wretched sinners. So I don't need nobody to put me down. I need somebody to pick me up. I've been down. I just need to be lifted up. Come on, somebody, can I get a witness? Oh, but the devil, he's like that. That's what he wants to play on. And he used people, amen, to get you in that position. And then when he gets you in that position, he's lowered your self-esteem. And then he'll cause problems. I said he caused problems. You know what the problem is in church? We allow the devil create problems in our hearts and our minds. And we feed off of it and we become prey to Satan because he puts those thoughts in our hearts and our minds thinking, you know, well, so-and-so ain't what they think you should be. Well, you ain't either. You ain't what you need to be. If you're talking about them, then you're not where you need to be. Hello? I come to church to worship God. Hello? I come to church to lift him up and to lift my brother and sister up. I didn't come here to put you down. Or to talk about you and tell you, you know, you don't wear your hair the way I do. Thank the Lord. Some of you are saying that. Thank the Lord. Oh, you don't tie your shoes like I tie mine. I don't have tied up shoes this morning. I just slipped them in the loafer, I guess what they call them. Amen. I just slipped them in. But friend, we need to get off of that stuff and realize that it's of the devil. I came to worship. Oh, the devil wants to put us down. Create problems with one another, and then he wants to create your family problems. Because if you see problems in your church family, I know you're seeing problems in your own family. But the problem ain't with others, it's with us. Wow, that's good preaching right there, sir. Go ahead, keep on preaching. Thank you, sir. I'm going to keep on preaching. Yep, I'm going to keep on preaching. Yep, I'm going to talk to myself too. Oh, I talk to myself all the time. I'm getting to a point, you know, where I'm doing in the yard or whether I'm working somewhere in the house or something. You know, I get tired because my body is worn out a little bit. And I sit down and boy, that chair gets so comfortable. And some of you are there too, amen, in service of God. You got to have that chair. We used to say pews, now it's chair. You got in that chair and it's comfortable. And you just sat there, and the devil said, just stay there. Because if you can sit there long enough, you'll get nothing done. Nothing gets done, right? So when I get into that mode, I talk to myself. Brother Moore, you got to get up from here. It ain't going to get done sitting here. Just get up from here. So we need to get up and not sit there. Or, remember, if you sit too long, the enemy is going to get you. Stay in that foxhole too long, let's see. He's going to shoot you, ain't he? He's going to zero in on you. He's going to find out where you're sitting at, and he's going to get you. Maybe that's our problem. Just thought about it. We sit too long in the same place in church. Switch it up some. Amen. Make the enemy look for you. Yeah. Some of you sit in the same old spot every time. I can almost count where you're going to go, left or right. I don't know why. Why do we like that? In the church, we want to sit in the back. At the concert, we want to sit up front. Man, I always want to sit up front in the church because I want everything the Lord's got for me. Hello? You don't want to get up on the front because the Lord might have you right down here. And you love your old lifestyle more than you love God, so you stay away from it. Farther I get front, oh, I don't want to walk all the way up here. You remember I told you, Satan, I'll use that. that's too far to walk. But if he got you up here on the front, you ain't got to take the two steps. You take the first one, he'll take the second one and put you right there on your knees. Woo! Ain't no better place to be. That's where life changes right there. That's where life changes, on your knees. Hello? We talk about God as can change us, right? And I tell you, he's working. I mean, he's working. He'll work in us if we open our heart's doors. But, you know, the devil, he attacks us. He makes us depressed, low self-esteem. He creates problems on top of problems in our families. And then he'll throw the icing on the top and give us an addiction of drugs or alcohol. Boy, he really wants to destroy us then. Because that stuff will take you to an early grave. Hello? I've seen it. I've been around it. And I know what it can do. The wages of sin is death. And who's the king of death? Satan. Satan is the king of death. But Jesus died for our sins. I want you to see that. Jesus died because he loved us. Jesus died for our sins. In Romans 5, 6, and 8, for when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. And that's every one of us. Forsakenly for a righteous man will one die, yet preadventure for a good man, some would even dare to die. But God commanded his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That means he died for not just only the good man, but the worst of the worst. He loved us. Nobody loved me like Jesus. Jesus don't want to see me depressed. He don't want to see me with low self-esteem. He don't want me to have no problems, no worries. And he certainly don't want me to mess up my mind with drugs or alcohol. Sober thinking. Be vigilant. Be alert. Your enemy's out there to destroy you with those things. Don't allow him to do that to you. And if you've been there and he delivered you, stay free in him. Trust him. Trust him. Trust him. Because he took the fatal wound that was due to you. In 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he had made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And I'm so glad of that. When I came to Jesus Christ and asked him to forgive me of my sin, that dark blot of my life went under the precious blood of the Lamb. And when it came out on the other side, it was white as snow, purity, holy. My righteousness is nothing. My righteousness will lead me to a grave. It will lead me to eternal death. But God's righteousness, Jesus Christ's righteousness, will lead me to eternal home. A holy environment. Pure, because when God looks at me now, he doesn't see Gary Moore. He sees Jesus Christ, his son. His image, amen, of himself. And he can't deny himself. He can't deny himself. And when he looks at you, he doesn't see you. He sees his son, Jesus. In Isaiah 53, 5, but he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquity. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. We are healed. I'm glad not only he loves me enough to save me and give me eternal life, but he loves me enough to take care of me, physically and spiritually. He can heal my diseases, and he can heal, amen, to the uttermost. And the Bible says all we have to do is come to him with faith. I love it when Jesus healed people here on this earth. He says, your faith has made you whole. Every time he says, your faith has made you whole. The problem is sometimes we don't believe he can take care of it. Right? Sometimes we put faith in man more so than in Christ. And we need to put it in Christ. I'm sure he uses men. I'm not saying nothing against doctors or whatever. But my faith should be number one in Jesus Christ. And maybe then he'll give that dummy enough education, amen, to help me out, amen, along the journey. Just saying. Amen. But my faith should be in Christ, in him alone. Now, Jesus, amen, loved me enough to die for my sin. And Jesus sets the captivity free and gives hope to those who believe. I was in captives of sin. I was captivated by that sin. And God, amen, set me free, like being in bondage, if you will. Oh, just like Peter, he was in bondage, right? Last week, he was in bondage, but it wasn't because he sinned. It was because he was doing what was right. Satan liked to keep him bound, to keep him from doing what is right. Satan likes to keep you bound, to keep you from doing what is right. But we got to call on Jesus to set us free. And he whom the Son set free is free indeed. It's free indeed. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me in Luke 4, 18 and 19. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captivity and recover the sight of the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord. No greater time than to know Jesus Christ, amen, died for your sins, and that he's here to set you free from that sin than today, right now, this time. This is an acceptable year of the Lord. He delivered us from this evil world. And I can't wait till that day comes when he delivers us from the evil of this world. The Bible tells in Galatians 1, 4, and 5, who gave himself for our sins that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God, our Father. To him be glory forever and ever. Amen. That's a blessed hope in itself. And the Bible tells me that God fills my heart with that hope. In Romans 15, 13, now the God of hope fill you with all joy, peace, and believing that he may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Ghost. That supersonic engine, Holy Ghost. Boy, I tell you what, he put some spring in your step when you ain't got none. Yeah. He'd give you joy where there is none. Boy, how many of you drive an automobile in here? That thing gets low on fuel. It won't go nowhere if it continues, right? When it gets down to that E, y'all tell my wife that when it gets to the E, it don't go. But when it gets to the E, it has no power. But isn't it wonderful when you pull up next to the pump and fill that thing back up? You can keep on chugging on down the road. And boy, I have to fill up at the Holy Ghost pumps just about every day. Help me keep on going down the road. That's high test. You don't hear those words much anymore, do you? The high test gas. Yeah, but anyhow, amen. Fill up at the Holy Ghost pump. And last thing I want you to see this morning, Jesus' defeat. He's going to defeat your enemy in the end. And he can defeat him today if he's after you. All you have to do is mention his name and the devil trembles. That's power. That's power in the name of Jesus. In my name, he said, you can cast out devils. In my name, not your name. You're no match for the devil. I'm no match for the devil. But Jesus' name, he trembles and fears. Why? Because he knows he has the power to destroy him and will do one day. He will do. In Hebrews 2, 14 through 17, for as much then as children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that has power of death. Satan has the power of death right now. But God is going to take that power from him and destroy him with death. Death. That the power of death, that is the devil, and delivered them who through faith of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. For verily he took not on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things he behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. The final death will come when our enemy is destroyed. Final defeat will come when our enemy is destroyed. The devil is overthrown. In Book of Revelation, all victory is just around the corner. 20:10, and the devil that deceived them were cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and forever. This is done through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, our greatest friend of all. Will not only, amen, save our soul here, take care, amen, of whatever's going on in our lives, will take us to heaven one day to be with him, will destroy our enemy once and for all, where he'll never bother again the people of God. I'm looking forward to that day. But the question is, do you know Jesus loves you? Do you know that Jesus died for you to set you free from all those things we talk about, depression, problems, circumstances, life in general? Just trust him today if you hadn't already. He loves you. He cares for you. And be ready when he calls your name. Life is short. So live to the fullness for the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be blessed in the end, forever and forever. It'll never end, forever and forever. Let us stand. Our Heavenly Father, God, as we come to you today, Lord, we are grateful and thankful, Lord, for the words we've heard through song and through your word today. Father, we are just 3 weeks away from celebrating that most important day when you rose victorious over death, hell, and the grave. Given us, amen, victory through trusting you. Father, may we trust in you now, those in the sound of my voice. If we hadn't already trusted you, today we'll trust you. And we'll give our lives to you to the fullness. And Father, help us to be the people you will have us to be. Help us be a light to the darkness of this world. Help us be the hope, God, that people look to. And Father, they can look to us, but Lord, they see you, that blessed hope of all hope.